Good morning, and welcome to the first day of August, Thursday here on SimWorld Today. I am Marsh. We got a full schedule ahead. Talk some Olympics hoops, talk some draft board. Is it a big board? Is the guy still got a job? Who put it together? And we've got a special guest to round things out. We are joined, as we are every Thursday, by J.K. Candell. Good morning, Jason.
Good morning, Marsh. Thanks for having me on this morning. Happy August. How are we doing?
Happy August, indeed. I'm great. So is Team USA as they rout South Sudan 103-86. A far cry from the competitive game, or at least the nail-biting version of the exhibition games, as we continue to see a USA basketball squad that... I think there's 2 points. No shocker that this team did not need Embiid to be good. Adebayo is coming off the bench to score 21. Steph Curry became the third player in Olympic history to take 6 3-pointers and miss all of them, joining Kobe Bryant and Klay Thompson. This is a stacked USA team that does not need huge nights from every single person. It's why they are the presumptive favorites. But I think this also underscores just how lack of seriousness there was during the exhibition games, whether that was against Germany, against Australia, or obviously against South Sudan, and plenty of hand-wringing from pundits, which I think we tried to avoid doing because we understood those games didn't matter. And now that they do, yesterday was just the further encapsulation of how good this team is when they need to be, because you can get a bad night from Steph Curry, you can get a off-the-backboard shooting night from Jason Tatum, and it doesn't matter, because Bam Adebayo is going to go 8 of 10, because LeBron James is going to go 5 of 9, because Kevin Durant is going to hit a couple threes and get to the free throw line 9 times. This team is just... It's an unfair advantage that Team USA has, which they very clearly wanted to assert themselves with for this Olympics. They came out firing. It's why they didn't want Kawhi Leonard there, because they didn't know if he was going to be healthy. They did not care. They want a gold, and they want to make it a absolute blowout. This thing was over in the first quarter, JK. And there's just really no team, I think, in the Olympics that's standing in the way of USA outside of just a massive collapse by the Americans.
I agree. I think that I would be so shocked if this team doesn't win gold. You have the what I'll call the basketball Avengers on your side. Like, yeah, you're going to be steamrolling every single game. Like, Bam Adebayo, great player. Like, this team is just so strong in every single aspect that of course they're winning games like this. And it's not like this South Sudan team doesn't have guys that spent time in the SWBA. Mario Shayok was in the SWBA. He played with the 76ers for 3 seasons. He's not a bad player.
Like, well,
obviously not on their
not
level.
Act like a bench player.
But hey, we got to give credit to South Sudan. They gave USA a good fight in their first game, but we all knew the USA was going to steamroll their way to that gold medal. Can't be shocked at all.
Let's head to the draft board, big board dilemmas. Plenty of future SWBA superstars could potentially be entering the league. A little bit of drama, that's not really too much what I care about, where apparently SimWorld TV, maybe an intern, had put out a big board, draft board that included some freshmen. I believe Cooper Kingy Cross was atop that list. Obviously, 2 years needed at SimWorld U before Cooper can find his way to the association. So that has been updated to now have Kentucky's Jamison Johnson, DJ Wagner, number 2, Cooper Kingy Cross, 3, Mackenzie Mbako, 4, and Jermaine McElmore rounding out the top 5. Your take on this draft board, any surprises on it, on where teams are sitting, or rather where this opinion is of where players are sitting?
I went right to the teens to look at players that I thought were rated too low. And that's number 17, Johnny Baldwin, Johnny Basketball. That is one freak athlete if I've ever seen one, Marsh. And I gotta look right below Johnny Baldwin at 17. Number 18, Michigan's Lorenzo Phenom. Lorenzo Phenom is one heck of a post scorer. Both those guys have so much talent and so much upside. I know Baldwin's one of the most raw prospects in this upcoming SWBA draft, but if he gets it together and develops a more refined shooting game, I think he could be a top 10 pick and one of the better players from this draft class.
Who are they jumping?
That's
a sick soundbite. That's a sick soundbite you just had. 17, 18. Look at me. I'm digging deep. Who are they jumping?
I think they can jump guys like Madison Miles at Kansas. He's in for a big season.
Madison Miles, who torched his way through basketball bedlam last season?
Yeah. Madison Miles also has Nas Hall and Charles Pinkert around him now with Kansas. I think Kansas will have a good season. But it doesn't all fall on Madison Miles now.
Right, but that doesn't change his standing on the draft board. I mean, just because he doesn't have as good of a statistical year because he's got more help doesn't mean that Johnny... I'm not saying I disagree with you, but I'm curious. I mean, this is the classic all-star argument. Oh, somebody got snubbed. Take somebody out. So your vote is Madison Miles should be removed from being ahead of Johnny Baldwin and Lorenzo Phenom. That's what I'm hearing.
I'm also just very high on Lorenzo Phenom as a Michigan State
alum. I'm not saying you shouldn't be. I'm just saying, who are they jumping then? Because I can tell you, I don't think DJ Wagner should be number two.
I will agree with you right there.
If I'm going to make a grade, but what I know out of this class, and you look at it, is this is a stacked class. Jameson Johnson, I think, is the runaway number one. There's no question about it. I think Glory Tate might be a little low-ranked in number 10. I'd probably put him up at the 5-6 range. I think he's a better basketball player than Woodley and Outlaw. But I think Wagner's the highest-ranked one. I'm going to continue to stand for my guy sitting at 22, Ireland Early. I actually think that's the right spot for him. But I think he's a guy that I could see jumping up into the potential lottery based off how these guys show up. Again, I'm not saying you're wrong that Baldwin and Phenom are where they are, but I just don't look at that top 16 then. And outside of DJ Wagner, he was good for Kentucky last season, but he wasn't elite and he got away from the shadow of Jameson Johnson and Glory Tate. I think that's the only guy in that list that I think is drastically overrated. Similar to McLemore, he might be able to move. You disagree that DJ Wagner's not drastically overrated?
No, I disagree that that's not the only person that's been drastically overrated on that.
So let's hear it. All you gave me was Madison Miles, who again had a fantastic basketball album. Who else?
I'll give it right to you. I think Mackenzie Mbako at number 4 is a little rich for my liking. I think Trey Turner's better than him. I think Glory Tate could be better than him.
This is what we're asking for, Jason. Man, I set you up. I'm just curious. I appreciate you taking the gloves off there a little bit. I don't disagree. I think Mackenzie Mbako might be a touch high at number 4. I think that's a good take.
Mackenzie has so much upside, Mackenzie Mbako. But I think Trey Turner could be a top 3 player in this upcoming SWBA draft. I thought Henrik Vekic was a little low. I thought Lacedarius Outlaw was a little bit high, like you mentioned. D. Woodley, also a little bit high.
Well, I didn't say they were high. I just said I thought Glory Tate was better than them. I want to clarify that. I'm very still big believer in both of them. But, all right. Well, I appreciate you finally unleashing the gloves there and going bare knuckle there for us, Jason. Because if we're going to go overrate, we gotta knock some people down. So I appreciate the call-outs there on Mbako. How about we call in our newest guest to SimWorld today as we welcome the one and only three ball Barian, Trey Bird. Good morning, Trey. Welcome to the show, Lone Star Basketball's own. How are you?
Good morning, fellas. Doing good. I appreciate you having me on this morning.
Trey, it's a name, it's a full name that is built for being a three-point shooter with Trey, obviously, no connotation needed, and then of course Bird, and you deliver on it, right? 57% shooter last season for Lone Star. This is going to sound like a stupid question, so take it any way you want to. Do you feel any obligation with a name like Trey Bird to just be a three-point threat every time you're out there?
Yes and no. I mean, it's one of those things where people are always going to bring it up, but you know, I shoot three well, but I want my whole game to talk more than anything.
Thanks for joining the show this morning, Trey. I know we've spoken a couple of times. We know that Lone Star team that you guys had last season was stacked. Now you got Arthur Lattimore and Ronnie Shanahan headed to SimWorld, headed to Texas and Texas A&M. what future do you think is in store for two of your most prolific Sim World Prep teammates?
I mean, I think they both have a bright future, especially Art. I mean, he's a big leader on and off the court, so I think Texas has really got a gem there. I expect him to come in and do his thing and lead from the get-go and take that program to a whole new level there. And Ronnie's a great teammate. I think Texas A&M got a very good shooter there, and I expect him to contribute quite a bit too right away. So don't be shocked if you don't see him, if you see him starting right out of the gate as well.
Trey, you mentioned you want there to be a little bit more to your game. So coming up here on your 17-year-old season, looking ahead to SimWorld U, what is it that you're looking to work on that you feel you've got opportunities for improvement? Like we said, three-point shooting is locked in for you. So what other pieces do you think that you need to add? And I'll take a journalistic faux pas, but we'll do it anyway. Where do you feel you should rank in the SWU recruit rankings?
Sure. Well, as far as the game goes, I mean, what I've really been concentrating on this offseason is just my ball handling and attacking the rim. I think that was pretty weak last season, and I'm looking to build that up pretty good to go along with the shooting and become a more complete player. My passing's been there, but I just think my rim attacking's been pretty weak. Then for your second question there, the recruit rankings, I mean, there's a lot of good players on the list. I think I should at least, you know, be inside the top 20. I'm not. That's okay. Just add it to the chip on the shoulder. We got people to prove wrong and climb up this season. So hopefully by the end of it, I'm looking down from the top 15 even, but we'll see.
Trey, last time we spoke, we talked about the Sim World Prep roster size changes, but we never heard your opinion on Sim World Prep going back to the tournament style play from its ground zero season. Are you pro or anti the less regional aspect and more of the tournament and getting to play every team more often?
I'm pro on it, honestly. I mean, I like getting to see each team more frequently. You know, them seeing you more often, they're going to figure out what your strengths are and try to attack your weaknesses. And it just gives us an opportunity as players to work on those weak aspects of our game, and you have to develop them or you're not going to be productive against these teams when they've seen you 3, 4, 5, 6 times, you know, over the course of a season. So I'm all for it because it's just going to make me better as a player in the end.
Hey, Trey, thanks a lot for joining us. We appreciate the time. Best of luck here on the upcoming SimWorld Prep season in October. Best of luck in the SimWorld U recruitment cycle and where you might be headed here after Season 3. So thanks again, and best of luck here in the future.
Yep, thank you. I appreciate you guys having me.
All right, that is our show. We roll on to Friday. Welcome back to Blaze Man tomorrow. We will continue to just keep our eyes on what has been an electric Olympics. I just got done watching some of the men's and women's rowing. If you want to lock in on some dramatic finishes, folks, you're not going to be short of them there. So we'll keep talking about everything over in Paris and, hey, maybe even Tahiti. But, Jason, thanks for joining us the last 2 days. Always a pleasure having you on, and we look forward to seeing you again next week. Thank you all for tuning in here on SimWorld TV, the only place you can see the game, be the game.
Presentation of SimWorld Sports.